I'd like to start by thanking the organisers for inviting me to this meeting, which I've thoroughly enjoyed up to now. My interest is in the ecology and evolution of plant reproduction, and I would like to start by just talking about the interest that evolutionary biologists have had ever since Charles Darwin in trying to explain organismal reproductive diversity. This slide just illustrates a wide range of organisms with all kinds of different reproductive strategies and a very active area of research in evolutionary biology is to try and explain why these have evolved and why particular groups often have dual reproductive systems. My own interest in this field started way back when I was a graduate student at UC Berkeley, and it was pretty much motivated by studying this organism, which is the world's worst aquatic weed, water hyacinth. And I think if you look at this picture for more than a millisecond, you can see there's an interesting issue here. And that is, this is actually one large clone, which is occurring in a drainage ditch in Florida. And what we can see here is this very classic peripheral flowering pattern. There's no flowering in the middle of the clone, only on the edge. And this is a very common observation in flowering plants that have clonal propagation, that the distribution of flowering shoots is not random throughout a clone, but is in fact in particular areas of the clone. And so that raises the question, why? And in this case, it's to do with the actual natural history of this species, which is native to the Amazon basin. And there, the species experienced dramatic water level fluctuations because of flooding in the Andes and the fact that the Amazon water levels go up and down. So during high water, this species reproduces clonally at a phenomenal rate. One plant can form a hectare of plants in a few months. So it's very good at clonal propagation. But particularly in the lower Amazon, those shallow lakes dry out. There is a season in the Amazon. And what happens then is the clones, their roots, which are dangling down in the water and absorbing nutrients, they hit the substrate, and that is a cue to start flowering, because essentially what happens is the clones completely desiccate. And so there's a burst of sexual reproduction. And this fits with what we heard this morning about the idea that under stress conditions, there are cues for sexual reproduction. I'll come back to water hyacinth. I just wanted to introduce this as a study system that I've worked on for most of my academic career. So let me sort of boil down what I see as the main issues that are of interest to a plant reproductive biologist and an evolutionary biologist in this interesting situation that we have with plants, in that we have both the opportunities for sexual reproduction and clonal reproduction. I'm not going to cover all of these in detail, but I'd like to give you a flavor of the kinds of questions that are being addressed in my area. One is, just what is it that cues sex and clonality? And this is looking at the proximate mechanisms governing the cues for flowering in populations. There's also a lot of interest in the idea about evolutionary trade-offs between sexual and asexual reproduction. And this comes about because one often finds within natural populations of perennial plants quite a bit of heritable variation in the relative allocation that genotypes make to sexual versus clonal reproduction. What I'm going to spend most of my time talking about is something that is probably less well appreciated, and that is that when plants get large, this can interfere with sexual reproduction, and this occurs because of particular features of plant populations. They're immobile in general, they're hermaphroditic, and there's an issue for cross-pollination as to how far pollen can be transported to secure cross-fertilization. So I'd like to talk about in some detail the issue of how clone size can affect pollen dispersal and fertility and the quantity and quality of mating. And then at the end, I'd like to talk a little bit about the loss of sex in clonal populations and how somatic mutations may play a role in the loss of sex. So this is the structure of my talk. I hope I'm not talking down to anybody here, but there is an arcane terminology in my field that has to be grappled with. Ever since Darwin and Linnaeus, there has been a sort of development of somewhat complex terminology for dealing with plant reproduction. So I just want to get us all on the same page and give a sort of a botany 101, or I prefer to call it plant sex and clonality 101. And that will be kind of a brief review of plant reproductive diversity. Then I'll talk about the interference between clonality and sex, focusing on particular groups that my laboratory has worked on over the last couple of decades. And then, as I mentioned, I'll look at the issue of somatic mutations and the loss of sex. So it's worthwhile, I think, just considering what are the distinctive, and notice I'm saying distinctive as opposed to unique, because many of these features also occur in other groups of organisms, particularly in things like corals. What are the distinctive features of plants that influence the way they mate? Well, clearly being immobile, at least during the sporophytic stage of the life cycle, is clearly a constraint. And in fact, the whole field of pollination biology, which is a thriving discipline within my general area, arises because people are interested in the vectors of gamete transmission between or transfer between plants within populations. The vast majority of plants are hermaphroditic. It's around 90%. Could even be a little higher than 90%. The separation of sexes in flowering plants is a relatively recent acquisition. We know from phylogenetic data that diecism, the separation of sex, has evolved repeatedly in about 45% of flowering plant families. But the fundamental sexual system of flowering plants is, in fact, hermaphroditism. And this is something that fascinated Charles Darwin. As you probably know, Charles Darwin was very interested. He was an excellent botanist. In fact, he wrote 6 books on plants, 3 of which focused entirely on plant reproductive biology. And he was very interested in the fact that plants were immobile and hermaphrodite, and therefore perhaps subject to inbreeding. And what we'll discuss a little bit today is some of the mechanisms that plants have evolved to reduce the incidence of selfing and inbreeding depression. Clonality, of course, is very common in flowering plants, and I'll go through the kinds of strategies briefly. Annual plants don't clone, not naturally, but many perennial plants do, and I think it would be fair to say that probably the majority of flowering plants, and there are 300,000 that have been described, have some strategy for clonal propagation. Plants are also modular organisms. They're made up like almost like a Lego set of modules, and this modularity is associated with something that most animals don't have, and that is the fact they produce multiple reproductive structures. So many, many flowers on a plant. Inflorescences composed of flowers. So there's a strong element of sex allocation plasticity in most plants, particularly clonal plants, that can adjust their allocation depending on the reproductive circumstances of different flowers or inflorescences in the population. And then also the life history diversity is enormous, going from very short-lived things such as Arabidopsis, which of course is a model organism for many molecular geneticists, right through to bristlecone pines that live for thousands and thousands of years. So we've got enormous life history diversity, and it's very interesting that the kinds of reproductive strategies have co-evolved with this life history diversities in ways that I don't have time to go into today. This is a very simple sort of terminological chart that just helps you with sorting out what is the difference, at least from the botanical terminology side of things, between reproductive system, sexual system, and mating system. So we talk about the reproductive system as the relative balance between sexual and asexual reproduction. And in fact, there's a continuum. Most species lie on a continuum between sexual and asexual reproduction. If we focus just on the sexual system, the majority of species are hermaphroditic, but some are dioecious with separate sexes. And there are even some species in which males, females, and hermaphrodites coexist, although that's quite unusual. And then finally, if we're just considering those hermaphrodite plants, we can consider the degree to which they self or outcross, how much selfing and outcrossing occurs within a given population. And there's a lot of interest in the fact that we know that self-fertilization is a common evolutionarily derived mating system in the flowering plants. It's evolved repeatedly from outcrossing, particularly in herbaceous groups. And so there's been almost an industry ever since Darwin raised the issue of inbreeding depression and Ronald Fisher pointed out that, you know, why isn't the world all selfing? Selfing genes should have an automatic transmission advantage. So really, the balance between automatic selection of selfing genes and the magnitude of inbreeding depression are the important parameters in thinking about the mating system of a particular species. Now, what about clonality? Well, there are different ways that species can reproduce asexually, and I'd like to dispose quite quickly, it's been mentioned earlier on this morning, with apomixis, because this is not something I want to talk about in any detail. But plants can reproduce asexually via seed through the process of apomixis. And there's a whole lot of interest in the evolution of apomixis in flowering plants. I'd like to focus instead on the other form of asexual reproduction, which is clonal propagation, or this goes by a number of different terms, and I'd like to point out that over the history of focusing on this other form of reproduction, different terms have come in and out of vogue. It's often called clonal reproduction or clonal propagation. Some people call it vegetative reproduction or vegetative propagation, but a key publication was John Harper's famous book on plant population biology that was published in the 1970s. Harper was a very influential British plant population biologist. And in a rather sort of polemical article, a chapter in his book, he sort of essentially banned the use of the term reproduction when referring to clonality, because he argued that clones are formed by growth and not reproduction. Now, I mean, I think it's a good idea. I think one should not necessarily slavishly adhere to this because clearly, as we'll see, there are plenty of strategies of clonal reproduction that do involve multiplicative growth where there are organs of reproduction. But if you just define it in terms of reproduction has to be the fusion of gametes and the production of a zygote, then technically, we're not talking about reproduction, according to Harper. Harper was enormously influential, and in the development of plant population biology, he developed a terminology which is now widely used by plant biologists, and that involves the ramet and the genet. So the idea is that a genet equals a clone, and a genet is made up of a collection of ramets. Ramets then are simply shoots. Again, harking back to the idea that plants are made up of modular units, a ramet equals a shoot. And I'll use this terminology as we proceed. Oh, yeah, and let me point out that there is an incredible diversity of strategies, and it would be interesting to know, and I'm not familiar with other groups sufficiently well, whether any other group of organisms has so many different mechanisms of asexual reproduction. These are all different kinds of strategies that plants have evolved to reproduce through clonal propagation. You can have tillers, you can have corms, you can have bulbs, rhizomes, tubers, rootsuckers, stolons, runners, bulbils, and turions. And I won't subject you to defining all of them. They're just all different ways that plants can grow and propagate. This trait of clonal propagation is actually quite evolutionarily labile. I'll simply show you a phylogeny from my laboratory done on a relatively small group of flowering plants in the Pontederiaceae. It's a family of 20 or 30 species, and there are at least four different clonal strategies within this family. That was published some time ago. We've recently discovered a new strategy in Pontederiaceae in the Pantanal of Brazil, where this one species has evolved stem tubers. So what we can see here is that these different kinds of organs of clonal growth can be quite varied, and there seems to be no strong constraints on evolving different kinds of clonal strategies among closely related species. So what are the benefits of clonal growth? Well, there are many, and I've just listed seven here. Obviously, the persistence of genotypes in habitats where sex is not possible. The division of labor among ramets, this is quite important in terms of sex allocation and the sort of idea that different parts of a clone can take advantage of particular patches of good environments. The ability to forage, there is now nice evidence to show that plants can forage, not in the way that animals forage, but in fact there is some directionality to clone, to stolon production in seeking out areas of high resources. There is obviously a sort of a bet hedging to clonal propagation in the sense that there is a spread of mortality across ramets of a clone. Parts of a clone may be subjected to very unfavorable conditions and there may be strong mortality, but as long as some ramets survive, the genet survives. As I'll emphasize very strongly in my talk, clonal propagules also facilitate dispersal, just like the dispersal of seeds. And I'll show you some examples, particularly in aquatic plants, of how clonal propagules are a very efficient means of moving genotypes around the landscape. And then there are these evolutionary advantages to cloning, which we heard a lot about this morning, but I'll just repeat them, the avoidance of costs of sex and recombination, and also the rapid replication of adaptive genotypes. And I'd like to introduce a terminology which was introduced actually from the Harper lab back in the 70s, and that concerned the idea of the different kinds of clonal strategies could be sort of maybe grouped into phalanx versus gorilla, depending on how intermingled clones become within a population. The phalanx strategy is just this sort of incremental increase in size of a clone without necessarily the production of stolons, which are almost like search vehicles, which are going out and tracking resource patches. And these different strategies have implications for the sex and the mating system of populations. If a clone gets larger and larger and larger, and particularly if they're not intermingled with other clones, then the selfing rate is likely to increase because of hermaphroditism. Now, Marcel Dorkin is going to be talking about this in detail tomorrow, so I don't want to preempt his theoretical model, but he has done a very nice model which actually looks at the extent to which clonality influences the mating system and how seed dispersal is also an important aspect of thinking about this problem. What I'd like us to just consider is the idea that the more intermingled clones are, the more likely outcrossing will occur. Now, Harper sort of had this dichotomy here, but in reality, if we look at all of those different strategies of clonal propagation, it's really a continuum depending on the type of clonal strategy that a particular species employs, going from those that essentially tend to favor more selfing within a population, and it's a particular kind of selfing, because what we're talking about here is, and it has a pretty awful name, and I apologize for this, it's called geitonogamous selfing. So geitonogamous selfing is simply the transfer of pollen between flowers on a clone. And we know theoretically that geitonogamy can never be adaptive. David Lloyd and others have done some very nice theoretical models showing that it's a lot easier to self within a flower than to have to pay the cost of bringing a pollinator in, having a showy flower and nectar, only to have your pollen then transferred to another flower on the same individual. So geitonogamy is not an adaptive thing. It's usually an incidental byproduct of growth. Just as the organism gets bigger, there is more opportunities for transfer of pollen between flowers within a genet. And then as we move through these various clonal strategies, we can get more opportunities for outcrossing because of more intermingling of genets within a population. Now, what I'd like to do now is to just go through some particular examples of where clonality has evolved in species that have sexual polymorphisms. And what I want to show is how this clonality can have reproductive consequences for pollen dispersal, fertility, and mating within plant populations. So, you might ask, well, why focus on sexual polymorphisms? I happen to have had a long-standing interest in sexual polymorphisms, and there are a number of reasons why they interest me. And what I mean by a sexual polymorphism is this. These plants are all, with the exception of Diece, where we have separate sexes, these populations are largely hermaphroditic, but the populations are subdivided into different mating groups. And so there are various strategies, and Darwin wrote a whole book on this. It was called Different Forms of Flowers on Plants of the Same Species. And the idea is that there is essentially persisting within a population different morphs or sexual types. And these types are different hermaphrodites, and usually they can't mate with themselves or other members of the same class. The only seed is produced with crosses between the sexual morphs. And all of these images across the top are different species I'm going to talk about, which have these sexual polymorphisms. The details really don't matter as to exactly what they are. I'll just mention them. These are all what are called heterostylous. They have different length sex organs. And you may know the classical primula story that was developed by Darwin. It's one of the classic examples of a supergene and a linkage group controlling a co-adaptive set of genes. And heterostyly is maintained in populations by negative frequency-dependent selection. And so I'm going to be talking quite a bit about these kind of styler polymorphisms. These are all heterostylous species. This one is distylous with two morphs. These three have three morphs. They're called tristylous, all of these. And then this is a very curious polymorphism that involves mirror image flowers. This is called enantiostyly. So what we have here are left-handed and right-handed flowers. And they essentially cross-pollinate one another because the pollen is deposited either on the right-hand side of the bee's body or the left. Single locus two-allele system, right is dominant to left. It's evolved independently in a number of different families, and my lab has actively worked on the function of that polymorphism. And then down the bottom here are several species that have separate sexes. And just to recall, that's quite rare in flowering plants. Maybe 7%, 8% of flowering plants have separate sexes. And they're usually on the tips of phylogenies. Unlike in animals, where separate sexes have a long evolutionary history, Dyeci is a relatively recent acquisition in most families. Okay, well, let's start off looking at this one species in China, Nymphoides peltata, which we worked on several years ago. And all I'm illustrating here is to show you that because this is an aquatic plant and it has mechanisms of dispersal in water, when we look at the morphs, these floral morphs, and in this case there should be two within a population, and the equilibrium expectation based on negative frequency dependent selection is 1-to-1, and in the tristylus case, 1-to-1-to-1. So that is the sort of the evolutionary stable morph ratio under negative frequency dependent selection. What we can see is that each of these populations, there's hardly any of these populations. This one's close to 1-to-1. But note there are some that are monomorphic. In other words, clonality and dispersal of propagules can result in populations being monomorphic for this mating type. And in those populations, there is no seed set because these plants are self-incompatible. Even in populations where there are two morphs, the patterns of fertility are affected by clone size. This is the fertility of flowers from the edge of a clone to another clone. So pollen being brought in by bees tends to pollinate the flowers around the edge of the clone, and many of the flowers in the center of the clone do not receive sufficient pollination. And as clone size gets bigger, more and more flowers fail. So clonality can really affect patterns of fertility in plant populations, particularly where we have the dispersal of vegetative propagules through water. And the species that perhaps best illustrates this, and we'll go back to water hyacinth, is Icornia crassipes. And again, this is very old work, but let me just illustrate the idea here and show you one consequence of this dispersal. In water hyacinth, the dispersal of these free-floating propagules in water is very common. They spread around the landscape. If they're introduced to other parts of the world, you get these enormous clones. This is in Louisiana, where this river is ruined now through clonal propagation. This is the world's worst aquatic weed. And what happens, and this doesn't happen here because there isn't the water level fluctuations that I talked about in the native Amazon and Pantanal, is that this is what you would get in the native range. And that water level goes down, everything starts flowering. And what has happened is very interesting is that since this plant has been dispersed to various parts of the world, and in some parts of the world, it occurs in seasonal environments, and if there's only one clone, and there is desiccation, and particularly if pollinators aren't common, there is going to be very strong selection for what is known as reproductive assurance through the evolution of selfing. And our work on Icornia crassipes has demonstrated that mating system modifier genes are selected in these monomorphic populations in seasonal environments to provide reproductive assurance, leading to a change in the sexual system from outcrossing, which we see commonly in the native range, to selfing in these introduced populations where there is just a single morph. There is a massive bottleneck associated with the worldwide spread of water hyacinth. As I said, it's native to this area of the world, but it's now in many countries of the world, and it's mostly the mid-styled form. And where long forms occur, they occur through selfing, because the genes governing the mid-styled form are heterozygous, and selfing then produces long-styled forms. The short-styled form is governed by another locus, and the loss of that allele effectively means that throughout the introduced range, we will never get the short-styled form back again through recombination. Some recent work done by myself and colleagues in China has looked at this issue of genotypes in different parts. This is the genotypic distribution of clones in the native range. It turns out in the introduced range, based on a fairly large global sample, 80% of these introduced populations are genetically uniform. 75% contain a single genotype. So there's been a massive bottleneck associated with this invasive spread. And in fact, these kinds of examples are very common in these invasive weeds, where strong founder effects followed by rapid clonal propagation can result in essentially genetic uniformity. This is the water hyacinth, which I just mentioned, but this is water lettuce. This is a very serious invasive aquatic. This is one of the most famous. This is kariba weed. This is particularly interesting because it's a fern, not a flowering plant. And there is no sex in the species because it's a sterile pentaploid hybrid. It may be the largest organism on Earth because this one clone occurs throughout the old world, from Australia right through to Africa, and it's a terrible weed. So how do these species do it without genetic variability? Well, of course, they do it through phenotypic plasticity, which, of course, is well developed in flowering plants. Plasticity we would define as the ability of a genotype to produce different phenotypes in different environments. And so phenotypic plasticity is very well developed in many of these clonal aquatics and enables them to deal with changing environments, both spatially and temporally. Now, the last example I want to give of these style of polymorphisms involves mirror image flowers, and I just want to show you how there is a signature of the reproductive mode on the distribution and frequency of these morphs within populations, which can tell you the kind of reproductive system that operates. And I'm going to look at a small clade. There's only about five species here, of closely related species, each of which has a different reproductive system. Wachendorfia paniculata is fully sexual, no clonal propagation. This one, the enantia stylus mechanism is broken down and it's evolved selfing. This species, Thuriciflora, is highly clonal. And so we might ask, well, what are the frequencies of the right-handed and left-handed forms within populations of these three species? These are the morph ratios from a sample of populations in the Cape, where this species is endemic. And as you can see, as you might expect from the frequency-dependent selection hypothesis, in sexual populations, we get even distributions of the two, of the left and right-handed morphs. Whereas we go to selfing, there's a lot of drift and founder effects involved in selfing populations. So we get a wide range of morph frequencies. And then in Thuriciflora, there also is a wide range of morph frequencies, including some that are monomorphic for one of those right or left-handed types, and in those populations, there is no seed set. And when we even map these out, we can see a pattern consistent with these three different kinds of reproductive systems. Random distribution of morphs in paniculata, but clustering in the two species with uniparental reproduction, selfing versus cloning. Now, I want to switch to diesy and, again, go back to some very old work that I did with James Thompson in the Neolithic. And this was work that I did when I first moved to Toronto from Berkeley. And I was very interested in sex ratios and the spatial distribution of males and females in populations. And James, we were rather foolhardy here. We sort of, our idea was to go into the boreal forest and map a full hectare plot and map every single ramet of what is called wild sarsaparilla, or Aurelia nudicaulis. And this is the map. This is one hectare. Took a long, long time and a lot of undergraduate help. And it was a bust, basically, because what we were hoping to do is to show that female ramets that were embedded in, let's say, the middle of a clone here would do far less well than ramets that were next to male ramets. And in fact, we found no effect. And actually, it was quite obvious when we started to do this, or when we finished, why. And that was because this is pollinated by bumblebees. There was quite good bumblebee activity. And bumblebees fly, you know, reasonable distances. So there really wasn't a constraint here on pollen dispersal. What we did find, however, which was really interesting, is that there was, in fact, an association with shade, the light levels in this forest. And so when we look at this, of course, we don't know that this is, in fact, one big male clone. Could be four, right? We didn't have genetic markers in those days to sort this out. And so what we, in fact, discovered at the ramet level, at the shoot level, is that in areas of high shade, males could flower repeatedly, whereas females couldn't. In other words, there was a difference between males and females in the propensity with which they could flower depending on the level of shade, which presumably is associated with the costs of reproduction and the fact that females make fruit, males don't. And what we now know is that that difference in the cost of reproduction has a dramatic influence on sex ratios. This is a recent survey that we've just done to pull together all of the data from flowering plants that we could find on sex ratios. And so what I've plotted here, each point is a different species. And so what we've got here is evidence that the classic one-to-one sex ratio that one expects, following Dusing and Fisher, the early ideas on frequency-dependent selection and sex ratios, certainly does not necessarily hold in every flowering plant. In fact, if one goes out and looks at sex ratios, there's a huge amount of variability, and male bias sex ratios are twice as common as female bias sex ratios. However, there's a caveat here. The problem with sex ratios in plants is those arguments by Fisher and others were to do with primary sex ratios. These are the operational sex ratios. We don't know what the genet sex ratio is because we don't have markers here, or at least we didn't, or haven't been worked out for all these species. In fact, we're just beginning now to develop sex-specific markers which will allow us now to actually look at genet sex ratios. So why do we have this strong male bias? Well, a lot of it is simply that males flower more often than females, particularly in clonal species where there are repeated bouts of reproduction. Often female genets take a few years off to build up the resources so that they can flower again. So we get these examples of male bias sex ratios primarily because males can get to flowering before females. They usually flower at a smaller size. They flower more often, and females, particularly in clonal species, tend to suffer more gender-based mortality. So a lot of this variation, then, is to do with clonality and the fact that we're measuring ramet sex ratios and not the primary sex ratio. We've recently been doing some modeling just to sort of confirm that there really are differences between clonal and non-clonal species. And so what we did here was we did essentially a metapopulation model with a level of colonization and extinction and just simply asked, what were the sex ratios depending on founder size and the mode of reproduction on sex ratios for populations of different sizes. As one might expect in a non-clonal species, one goes to one-to-one pretty quickly in this model, whereas in clonal species, everything is slowed down. The approach to equilibrium is very, very slow, simply because sexual recruitment in many of these populations is very limited, and therefore the ability for negative frequency-dependent selection to sort of drive the sex ratio to the equilibrium of one-to-one-to-one is slowed right down. And so then we surveyed a set of species, 49 here and 52 there, to see how they matched, and there was a reasonable funnel-shaped relationship that one might expect in sexual species for different population signs, whereas in clonal species, a lot of this scatter probably just simply reflects non-equilibrium conditions. Now, I want to talk a little bit about Monisi and Diisi now in Sagittaria. And this is work, by the way, of Marcel Dolkin, who will be talking tomorrow. Marcel was a graduate student in my lab and did a very elegant study where he exploited the fact that Sagittaria latifolia, this species that we have quite commonly in eastern North America and a little bit in California as well, actually has both combined versus separate sexes. So Sagittaria latifolia has monoecious populations. These are hermaphrodites with separate male and female flowers. There's the male flower, there's the female flower. This would be a monoecious population. But then some other populations have male individuals and female individuals, and they're dioecious. And Marcel was able to demonstrate that these two sexual systems are associated with quite different life histories and are ecologically segregated from one another, occurring in different kinds of aquatic habitats. The monoecious populations occur in very, very impermanent, ephemeral habitats, drainage ditches, farm ponds, and the dioecious populations tend to be in much more stable, large marshlands that occur along the large lakes, particularly in eastern Canada and northern US. And I should say, both of these population types have the ability to propagate clonally. And this is how they do it. They can either produce stolons, which then produce another ramet, which can flower or may not flower. And then they also can overwinter and propagate through asexual corms. This is a monoecious individual illustrated here. Now, we're pretty interested here in actually figuring out what are the sex ratios in these clonal populations, and how can we get at this? And so this is work that we've recently published in Molecular Ecology, where we simply ask the question, what is the relationship between ramet and genet sex ratios within a set of dioecious populations? We were also interested in comparing clone size in monoecious versus dioecious populations and various other parameters of genetic diversity. And so what we did here was use spatially explicit sampling in 10 monoecious, they're hermaphrodite populations, and 11 dioecious populations, those are populations with separate sexes, at the range limit here between Quebec and Ontario. And what we found actually was quite satisfying from the standpoint of the practicality of using ramet sex ratio as a surrogate for genet sex ratio. Given what I had told you, we thought that we might find that actually there was rather a poor relationship, primarily because of the possibility that male clones might produce more ramets than female clones. But actually, we found that there was a fairly nice correspondence between ramet and genet sex ratios. So we can now use ramet sex ratios as a sort of a reliable, more or less predictor of the genet sex ratios. And we also found, based on the marker data, using the multi-locus microsatellite marker data, that there was no evidence for a difference in clone size between males and females. So the idea that the cost of reproduction in females might limit the growth of clones was not supported. We also found, and this was a slightly surprising result, that clone sizes were actually larger in monoecious populations than dioecious populations. We had sort of predicted that perhaps clone sizes would be larger when the sexes separate, because there would be no cost in those populations to gynogamy, to selfing, so they would be released from that constraint. But in fact, we did not find evidence for that. We found evidence that monoecious populations actually had larger clone sizes than dioecious populations. As predicted, there was more clonal diversity in the dioecious populations, which would be based on the prediction of the mating system, since these are obligately outcrossing populations. It's not surprising they're maintaining more diversity. And we found that in terms of our range limit comparison, there was a much steeper decline in diversity in dioecious populations as we went north in eastern North America. And I think that can be explained by the fact that that particular range limit here, which is illustrated on this map, is the range limit for the dioecious populations, But these hermaphrodites in Monetius populations actually spread at least 500 kilometers further north. And maybe if we'd have looked at the range limit of those populations, we would have found the sort of decline that we saw in dioecious populations. Okay, I'd like to sort of now move on to the last part, and this is where we move into sort of more speculation than hard data, simply because this has not been a particularly attractive area for people to move into, partly because of the difficulty of actually measuring somatic mutations, and I guess the fact that markers weren't available until relatively recently. But I'd like to go through three recently published pieces of work, which I think actually are quite encouraging and suggest that there may be processes operating in dioecious populations that clonal populations that could lead to sexual dysfunction and the loss of sex, particularly at range limits. And I want to sort of set the historical background here and actually give credit to somebody who often is sort of not looked at, or his work perhaps has not been given the credit that I think it deserves, and that's Ed Klukowski, who at the University of Massachusetts many years ago wrote a very interesting book called Mutation, Developmental Selection, and Plant Evolution. And he argued that actually somatic mutations actually could be a fairly important selective force affecting very many aspects of plant evolution. And that work sort of really did not catch fire, but I think it was for practical reasons rather than anything conceptually wrong with it. And sort of the background here is, of course, and I don't have to tell people in the audience here, plants violate Weismann's germplasm theory, and essentially plant chimeras and somatic mutations do occur in plant populations. In fact, there's a whole area of plant biotechnology that is based on somaclonal variation. And anybody, those of you familiar with the horticulture industry, will know that somatic mutations have been responsible for many of the cultivars that we see in gardens and in glasshouses. This is, in fact, a chimeric conifer here. So interestingly, with regards to these somatic mutations, there's sort of been two kinds of perspectives. I mean, one has been, and this is quite controversial, I think, that, you know, this is an adaptive process, and by producing genetic mosaics, trees, for example, can be protected against herbivory, because now herbivores are confronted with a complex genetic mosaic. There's not really any good evidence for that. And I think since most somatic mutations are either neutral or deleterious, it's probably more sensible to focus on their harmful effects or their negative effects, which is what Klukowski did in his book. And if we're going to pick any group of plants that is going to be affected by somatic mutations quite strongly, it presumably is going to be clonal plants and very large trees where there are huge numbers of cell divisions and meristematic activity and very long, long life. So here is a very interesting paper that was published in PLOS Biology by Ali, Ritland, and Otto from UBC, which looked at this rather interesting situation in trembling aspen, where in fact trembling aspen clones occurring in the Great Basin are of enormous age because there's no sexual reproduction going on. The climate has changed, sexual recruitment does not occur in those populations, and there's been a lot of interest in trying to age clones. And so without going into all of the data, they use microsatellite data to come up with a rather interesting way of estimating clone age of these different clones. And then they asked, do clones of different age vary in their male fertility? And male fertility was assessed by looking at the viability of pollen. And they found that the older the clone, the more likely they were able to find sterile pollen. This is a rather interesting finding, and it suggests that if this is common, we might get this as an important process in clonal plants, where in fact, over time, large clones accumulate these somatic mutations, affecting various aspects of reproduction. And one good example of that, again, work that Marcel Dorkin and colleagues have done, is in Decadon. Decadon, or swamp loosestrife, this is related to the invasive weed purple loosestrife. At the margins of the range in Ontario and Quebec, populations are largely sterile. And it turns out the sterility, and this is sort of illustrated here with just one fruit, There should be fruit all the way up this this inflorescence here. When you do hand pollinations, this is nothing to do with these plants not getting pollinated because of marginal conditions for pollinators at the edge of the range. This is that these plants are, in fact, genetically sterile. And so we have these sterile populations, which are essentially entirely clonal at the margins of the range. And the genetic basis of this sterility has not been worked out, but I think it will be very interesting to see whether somatic mutations may have played a role. And then finally, the last example I want to go through goes back to my former PhD supervisor, H.G. Baker, and this is a very opportune time to raise this piece of work, because as you may or may not be aware, last year was the 50th anniversary of probably one of the most important symposia in evolutionary biology, which was held at Asilomar in 1965 and attracted some of the leading luminaries in evolutionary biology, Dick Lewontin, Ernst Mayr, Waddington, E.O. Wilson, G. Lydiard Stebbins, and so on. This was the famous symposium on the genetics of colonizing species. And H.G. Baker wrote a very provocative paper that was published in that symposium volume, in which he proposed that there were certain kinds of invasive genotypes that had what he called a general-purpose genotype, jack of all trades, master of none, and that these were often the results of hybridization. Sometimes they were sterile, and they almost always had uniparental reproduction and were clonal. And the example he used to sort of highlight, one of the examples he used to highlight this was Oxalis pescapri, the Bermuda buttercup. And for those of you who are from California, you will know this because it's a very common invasive weed throughout the state. Now, he envisioned this because it was a sterile polyploid, it was a pentaploid, as a single genotype that had now colonized the world from its native area, South Africa. It indeed occurs in Chile, California, and the Mediterranean and Australia. And the sterile pentaploid dominates throughout this area. However, we've recently analyzed genetic variation in this clone and found that, in fact, it's not a clone. There are lots of clones. There is, in fact, quite a lot of genetic variability. And so the question is, where does this genetic variability come from? And again, I suggest that one of the possibilities is that somatic mutations have played a role in generating this diversity. Okay, so in general, the general conclusions then to my talk, I think sexually polymorphic plants provide very good opportunities for investigating the reproductive consequences of clonality. And extensive clonal growth can have important functional consequences for plant fertility and mating patterns. And we'll hear more about that from Marcel tomorrow. Large clone size and the limited intermingling of genets, particularly where we have dispersal of propagules either through water or through by humans moving them around, can interfere with sexual polymorphisms, resulting in both female and male mating costs. And then finally, the evolutionary significance of somatic mutations in clonal plants is not well understood. We have very few examples, but it may play a role in the loss of sex, which is often observed, particularly at the margins of the range of clonal species. Thank you.